What's up, my beautiful people? Welcome to All Ball Chicago. I'm your host, Marcus Liberty. I got my main man, the Matrix, in the building, man. My man, Shawn, Marion, man. What's going on?
Man, I'm chilling, you know, just like everybody else. We're doing this pandemic right now, just trying to stay safe, man.
Man, that's what's up, man. I'm glad you can join me today, man. And I wanted to actually talk to you about some things, man. Actually, how you started, you know, where you started playing the game of basketball. I know you were living in Waukegan, Illinois, but tell our listeners, man, so they can get a better understanding of how you really got involved in the game. Who put the rock in your hand?
Put the rock in my hand. I think I want to say it'd be my uncles, man. You know, I had a long tree of basketball in my family. You know, they didn't go far with it, but they definitely played the game a little bit. They was physical with me. And they christened me early in my adolescence. And, you know, I just stuck with it. You know what I'm saying? You know, a lot of times when you're young, back then growing up, when you're really young, you don't know if you're really good enough when you're young or not. Anyway, when you're really young, like in third and fourth grade, you're really a little kid. It's a little different now than it was when we was coming up. It take way longer to get found. So, but you know, I mean, I had a passion for it, you know, and I just stayed with it. And I always wasn't able to play, you know, on a team because of the situations and some of the schools I went to didn't have teams. They just,
oh wow,
back you know, it's crazy. Back some elementary schools just didn't have basketball programs, you know. So especially I was in suburbs, so you know. Me jumping around from North Chicago to Waukegan to Zion. And then, you know, I spent some time in Chicago Heights and throughout the city, just seeing family and friends throughout the times and stuff and just playing the game, you know. And we all started outside. You know, that's the only way, you can start. Who got access to a gym? You know what I'm saying? Right. So from the court, it just escalated. And then, you know, I was fortunate enough when I started getting really good, though, it was when I was pretty good when I was 12. But when I left Illinois and moved down south to Tennessee on my mom and them, and it was probably around that time when I really, really started really getting good. And I was still coming back and forth to Chicago because my grandparents lived in North Chicago and I was staying with them in the summertime. And I was able to play, you know what I'm saying, up there at the youth centers and stuff and get it in.
Right.
But for the most part, though, it was like I only could go back during the summertime because I was in school, of course. But then this, once I got older, I was able to play high school ball and I started playing AAU ball, you know, and got a household name down there. And I still was going back and forth to Chicago when I got the opportunity to, and that's why I ran into the Urbans, and Mr. Urban took me in, and like it was probably right after high school when I was going, when I was in junior college, and I was able to be in the city more because then I was old enough to drive and a car, you know what I'm saying, and then I was able to you know, grown with someone a little bit. You were able to maneuver a little bit better. And I was in college, so it was just an ongoing transition for me. And I got invited to Jordan Camp out there at Elmhurst on the west side, you know. Mm-hmm. And I was working at camp being a junior college All-American and stuff. And at the same time, I'm doing all the summers, though. I'm playing in the summer league at IIT. And it was just like, you know, when you playing ball at that time, you know, it's going from back to back. It's like one tournament after the next, from AAU to you know what I'm saying, to being an AAU national All-American to, you know what I'm saying, playing IIT to doing all this. It was just like it felt like it never stopped. You know, it was just nonstop basketball. You know, I was just jumping from every – I was just going to play anywhere I could possibly.
Right.
And, you know, once I fell into that certain circle, though, you know, with Mac and Irving, you know, they made sure that, you know, everything just lined up. You know, and I started with Chops. So remember Chops?
Who's that?
You remember Chops? So Chops.
Yeah.
So him and I actually played with him and what's his name first? I was on their team, and then they basically Mike and them kidnapped me. I was playing with him and it was Chops and because Chops passed away.
Okay.
Chops passed away. It was and I'm trying to think. so many people that I'm kind of brain froze right now. But it don't matter though. Like I was, it was an ongoing process though. You know, so I was with them, and then when I was younger, then all of a sudden, you know, Twan takes me in. Once I get to, you know, what I'm saying, well, he took me in kind of a little bit when I was in college as well, doing that process. He kept because he had Adidas deal, so he was blessing me with Adidas doing while I was in school. You know what I'm saying? So I had all the fresh kicks when I was in college. So I had endless shoes. Everybody was like, "You in college? How the hell are you getting all these shoes on your Pell Grant?" But it was just like I was in the circle, so like we was all together, and then we was like, he was just a little older than me. Right. Like all of us was in that circle right there together, and it was just family, and it just kept going, and then we stayed like that, and then for the most duration, and you know. Once it really happened, it happened, and it felt like it went by so fast. And but I sit back here and replay so many things from going to play at the West Side of LeClaire, like going to the gym, and one of the craziest moments ever. And I was in junior college at the time. This is so dope. So like I had at the time I hadn't played against Mike Gilliam hadn't played in summer league yet. I hadn't played in the summer league. I played Timmy. Timmy played them. Timmy gave me some work in the summer league at IIT, but
right.
Mike Gilliam hadn't played in it. So Mike and so I go up to the gym at the West Side of Claire. You know, they ain't even there. The Claire course ain't even there no more. They tore that down. It's all gone.
All gone now?
It's been gone. Yeah, they tore them down. You know, ain't nothing there over here now. I think they're getting ready to build some duplexes over here.
Oh, okay.
But anyway, so I pull up to the gym. I went with Mike and Antoine in that morning, and we get to the gym. I see a Ferrari out there. I see a Porsche. See a Navi. No, I don't Navi. I see a Range Rover. I'm like, okay, who in the gym? So you already know it was Mike Finley, Juwan, Tim. You know, anybody who was basically in the league at the time was there, and that's what it was about,
right? And,
somebody just came in. I just seen
that's
somebody.
That's my boy. I'm gonna let him in.
Yeah, Rob. So like, it just like, man, it just brought back memories. What up, Rob? Yeah. So it was just like so many memories. And I went in there, and it was like the first time I got a chance to play against Mike Finley and Juwan. I played against Timmy because he played in summer league, of course.
Right.
But and Twan, of course. But like. The first time playing is Mike Finley and Juwan. I mean, and that's when they was like, man, after that day, that one day in Hope, they was like, yeah, he ready. Yeah, he ready. He going to be there because I gave him work that day. Yeah.
Wow. But, Shawn, what I remember watching you, man, because I watched you when you were at UNLV. I didn't get a chance to watch you when you was at Vincennes. But I heard a lot about you, man, like on the court. Like, you're a hell of a rebounder. And a lot of people don't know, and I heard this from some of your friends, man, that you actually played point guard, you know, in high school, you know. So that shows you why you had those handles, because I was like, he got some handles at that size, you know.
Well, you know, it's funny you say that because, you know, I didn't play point guard in high school, but I was starting point guard in junior college at Vincennes.
Oh, okay.
So that's where a lot of that stuff came in, and they was comparing me to Scottie Pittman. Because I could have came out my freshman year in junior college. A lot of NBA scouts come and watch me then, but I was like, you know, I'm having a good time in college right now. I still want this education. Still, I need to learn these books. So I was like, you know, I ain't ready to go just yet. You know what I'm saying? That basketball NBA don't be there. I ain't ready to just go just yet. And excuse me. And it was just a great feeling. And you know, it was just a great time I had. I reminisce about those days all the time. But I just had a ceremony there in January. They get retired.
Well,
they already retired. They retired it was like 15 years ago. But they gave me a ceremony though. They gave me an actual ceremony. They did a ceremony for me. So like that was really special because a lot of times during our season, it's kind of hard to get away just for a retirement ceremony during the jersey. Usually, if you're close within the vicinity, now guys are because back when I was doing, guys wasn't really flying private like that. You know what I'm saying? That's really a perk that. A lot of us really can't afford. We just do it anyway because we think we can afford it. You know, you just rent the plane just for a little bit. It's costing a lot of money. You know what I'm saying?
But
for the most part, though, typically a lot of guys during their careers can't go back unless it's a day off or something. They can go back for retirement, but depending on where it's at, it doesn't really line up in your schedule.
And that's what I wanted you to speak on a little bit, Shawn, too, about the junior college. Because a lot of people think that, you know, they have to go certain routes, you know, whatever the reason was that you went that route, you know, kind of explain to them like how the junior college process works and making sure you pick. I think that it's another legend that went to that school too, right?
Oh, it's a few others that went there. It's a few guys that went pro went there.
Right.
Tyrone Nasby, Landry Fields went there. You know, right now, Bonzi Wells' son is in school there.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So, listen, they turn out some great prospects there. You know, it's a great junior college, man. It's not even – I wouldn't even consider it a junior college. It's almost like a Division I. It's a real campus, man. It's real life down here. It's awesome.
Wow.
I love it.
Wow. So Shawn, how did you skip over – because Vincent is in Indiana, right?
Yeah. So
how did you skip over Indiana University, Purdue, Illinois, and go all the way to UNLV?
Well, so look, the junior college process, I'm going to start with it because you're talking about the school going the junior college route. You know, I think everybody get discouraged with that. No, listen, I was a very, very smart guy, you know what I'm saying? But sometimes, you know, certain things I just didn't know, you know, and I'm not oblivious to say it or, you know, right, arrogant to say it. I don't know everything, you know, and I was pretty, my grades was always good in school. I couldn't pass the ACT. So, and I, back then, they offered both of them for us. You had a choice to take the ACT or the SAT. Okay. So I only took the ACT, and then I made a 16. You needed a 17 to go to Division I back then.
Right.
So I missed it by 1 point, and I had some of my other colleagues at the time, some of my high school guys I was competing with. They didn't pass it. They first go around either, but they waited and took it again because, you know, it's take an average of how many times you take. It's the best average you get score-wise. So if you get a 16-1 and you get a 17 or 18.5 on one of them, you can pass it then. You know what I'm saying? Right. So it's only the best score on it. But – only took it one time, and I got 16. I was like, do I really want to wait and take another one? Because it was always in the fall. So if I would have took it, I would have had to start school late. So I was like, no, I think it's time for me to go ahead. So I went and looked at junior college. It was like, go to junior college. I looked at two schools. I went to Northwest Mississippi and visited that school, and it was a nice campus. And then I visited Vincennes. The Vincennes was halfway between Clarksville, Tennessee, where I was at, and Chicago, and it was easy for my family to maneuver and get there if they wanted to come see me.
Right.
So I went to Vincennes, and I was like, I ain't gonna go nowhere else though. I was like, I'm locked in. Coach Sparks and the staff there, the guys there, man, they had D1 set. They had D1 programs set up there already in junior college. It was the way they had our individual workouts and the schooling and stuff. It was set up, man. It was set up awesome. And, you know, the transition was amazing for me. It was easy for me. I ended up becoming an academic All-American.
Wow.
And, like, I was locked in, though. Like, you know, like, don't get it twisted. Certain things, like, you know, when you're in high school, you're playing a lot, and, you know, some of that stuff, it goes in one ear out the other so fast, you forget it. You know what I'm saying? But when you get to college, though, you know, these are the tools that you need that's gonna benefit you in the long run down in your life. You know what I'm saying? So you need basics, and you need to know how to do certain things to make sure you can make it in your life. That was the foundation they laid for me, you know what I'm saying? So, I mean, junior college is amazing for guys who want to continue their, you know what I'm saying, playing ball and education. If you can't go to Division I, you know what I'm saying? Right. If some guys who don't want to go D2 or D3 or whatever, if you want to go to junior college, that's not a bad route. And they're going to find you now. It's a lot easier to find guys talent-wise in junior college or anywhere now versus it was when we was playing. Because the people had to really come out because we weren't able to watch or see videos or internet on guys doing such and such. You couldn't do that back then. Right. Now, with all this stuff, with all the internet and social media stuff, you can see guys and you can post up on your own and get out there and get all the exposure you need right now. But that's the transition, the difference of now from the escalator of the game and how it is right now. But it's pretty sweet, though, man. It was pretty sweet. It was just it was a learning curve. And then, you know, I ended up going to Vegas because I wanted to get out the damn cold. Dude, I was tired of being in the Midwest, man. Well, that hawking, that nice. I was like, let me go out here and give me some sun and some sunshine. So I actually visited USC too because Henry Bibby was a coach up there when he was recruiting me hard out there. And I was like, oh, but people don't know this, and this is crazy. So my dream school was to go to North Carolina.
Okay.
So I actually was going to go to North Carolina. They had a scholarship. Dean Smith offered me a scholarship. But he ended up retiring before, right after my last year playing. And I was like, well, my freshman year. And I was like, well, I ain't going there now. He ain't there. So, like, that was part of it. That was a big part of me.
Wow, so you was going to be a Tar Heel.
Yeah, so the only other person that he ever got from junior college, because he just typically don't take guys from junior college, was Bob McAdoo. He came from Vincennes.
What?
Wow.
The only other guy that ever came from junior college to go to North Carolina at the time. So I couldn't tell you they got anybody since then. But I was going to be the second guy to ever come out of junior college to go to North Carolina.
Wow.
Yeah. I got. Can I hop in, man? I'm late, man.
Yeah.
Sean Mary, nice meeting you, bro. Sorry about this, man. I just want to ask, who did you patent your game after, man?
You know what, man? You know, I loved a lot of players, man. And I, you know, I mean, I got a lot of comparisons to Scottie Pippen coming up and coming out, you know, saying that was the number one. Oh, he's a Scottie Pippen type player with maybe quicker hops, you know what I'm saying? You know, I loved everybody, though. I loved a lot of players. I loved Scottie Tenassi and the way he was a two-way player. I loved MJ, of course. Who don't like Black Jesus? And then Reggie Miller was one of my all-time favorite players, though, dude. I love Reggie Miller. I just feel like he was just so skinny and just like – he just had so much heart for his size that, like, you know, he was just like, man, you know, he's going to come at you regardless of what how big he was over here or not. That little motherfucker was But yeah, I love a lot of other guys, man. You know, I respect the game of a lot of guys who paved the way for us, man. You know, the legends. Man, you gotta have so much respect for the guys that paved the way and gave us the opportunity to do what we're doing right now. You know, all the Bill Russells and the Will Chamberlains and all these guys, all the guys that came before us. They paved the future for what the game is right now, and you know, we're steady growing.
You know what I noticed too about your game, Shawn, that a lot of people probably, they really don't talk about your IQ. Your IQ was like really good, man. Like you never took any bad shots. You just, it seemed like you, wherever you went, you was like, you know what? I know what I'm good at and I know what I'm going to do when I get there. So I ain't got to try to do some things that I ain't trying to do. Like you had Jason Kidd as one of your point guards. Then you had Steve Nash, two of the best passers in the game. You know, and just talk about, you know, those guys that, you know, the point guards that you had, like Jason Kidd and
So I came in with Jay Kidd. I came in with Jay Kidd and Penny Hardaway, you know, backcourt 2000. Them two, you know, Jay Kidd is an on-court coach. You know, Penny Hardaway, you know, one more name is Penny PH, man, giving the people that work, you know, so that real dog, you know. And just telling him, he was a really skilled player, man. All of guys were. I had some great veterans on my team and early when I came into the league. And, you know, one of the things I did, though, I was really open-minded to learning the game and learning how to be a professional athlete. I learned how to be a pro, man. A lot of these young guys don't know how to be pros. It's easy to be an NBA player. It's hard to be a pro. It's a difference. And that's the knowledge I want to pass down and pass the torch. But at the same time, though, you gotta have guys that's willing to listen and want to learn and ask questions and don't be so arrogant and and they're just so self-entitled these days, you know what I'm saying? And that's the sad part. I just wish these guys would humble themselves a little bit more. They act and they say it, but they don't do it. You know what I'm saying? Saying and doing two different things. But I just, you know what I'm saying? I got so much of this game and so much knowledge of this game. And I played at a level that, you know, I don't see it in a lot of guys anymore. You know what I'm saying? And it's kind of disheartening to a certain degree because of how competitive I was. But the game is – but we got definitely got some great talented guys in the game right now. I'm not taking out.
Right. And it seemed like it seemed like Shawn, you love the game though.
I do. It's parts of it I love. When I'm talking about it, and when I talk about the game, I talk about it from the experience part though. Like because a lot of guys just talk about things that they see. It's the difference between when you're in the clutches and that battles and that cut right there, and you've been in that tight situation when the clock is going down. Or better yet, you know what you're feeling, what you're going through, what the team is going through when you're on the court with them versus of sitting back watching, trying to piece it bit by bit to try to figure out where I fit in, where I don't fit in, all this other stuff. There's so much about the game that people who never really played the game have been in clutches have so much to say about it. And one of the things I learned throughout my career is the media can control the narrative on a lot of things of how they push players, how they push teams, coaches, everything. They control pretty much everything about the game, all aspects. So it's the only way people know what's going on, what you're thinking, is if you speak up and say what you're thinking, how you're feeling about the situation. Now they always take bits here and there because they never really show 100% of all interviews or nothing. And that's why I when I'm doing interviews now, I try to give everybody a different perspective of the game, because everybody always talk about how Phoenix team that we lost against the San Antonio Spurs should be the team we won a championship on. I was like, the game that Mari and them got suspended, you know what I'm saying? They always talk about that game. I was like, y'all started that narrative. Y'all created that narrative, think that was the team should have won a championship. I didn't feel that. I didn't think that was that team. Y'all create that narrative. So when they create that narrative and they start seeing it, y'all eat it up. The fans, the people who watch it, y'all right. eat it up like it's candy. Like, oh, yeah, right. we eat that. We all eat it up. You know what? They got a point there. No, that ain't how it works. No, that ain't how it works. No, that's not. Just because y'all say something don't always mean it's right, man. And,
right.
And when you're a player and you're in them trenches and you're in them locker rooms and you know the feeling, you got that vibe around the team, that chemistry, that bond, that feeling that, no, you can't really talk about it. It's that feeling that you just really feel in your heart and in your vibe and the aura of the team, and you can't really talk about it. It's kind of hard to really voice your opinions about it. So, you know, on that mindset, though, you don't know. I mean, everybody has expectations. Everybody. Every team, when the season starts, everybody got expectations. Let's be real. So everybody think they can win a championship. But right. in the real life, in the GMs and the managers and the coaches know, ain't but like four or five teams that actually probably can win it.
Right,
come on,
right.
Come on, like, actually really can win it.
Every year.
So when you break it down, like, it's not that hard, though. Look at the teams. If you want to break down so much about the game, look at the teams that are – The championship that have been won in all these teams. A lot of them have already won championships. So it's like
right.
for them, it's already if a team has already won four or five championships, or five, six, or seven, eight championships, and they ain't won one in about 4 or 5 years, guess what? Soon it's about that time, dude, they're gonna win one. You know,
right.
it just is what it is, you know.
Right.
Every team, now every blue moon you'll have a Cinderella team win a championship. Like last year, you had a team that nobody was expecting to win it, came out the Eastern Conference, Toronto pulled it off and won the championship. You know, right. And then right. say ours was too, because it wasn't when you win one off, that's kind of how you relate it. But when you win back to backs, it's a different story. Or if you're there in the finals every year, giving yourself a chance, sooner or later you gotta cross that threshold. But dude, like, it's so much that go on with this game that everybody just say. I think they know the game, and all y'all doing is talking about it from y'all perspective, what y'all seeing. Y'all don't know what's really going on. That's why I'm loving The Last Dance too, man, because they tell it from a player's perspective really what happened. Well, really, not what the media said. Even though what the media said, they're telling you why the media said that or why they thought the media thought that, but they're giving you the real now. They're giving you the real uncut version of really what went down.
That's wild.
You got something, Bob? You good?
Yeah, I wanted to ask him, man, you know, how special was that 2011 championship team, though? That was a special team, boy.
So you know, me and Karan did a podcast yesterday. We was live on NBA Alumni Instagram yesterday. So I think we reposted it. You need to go check it out, because he asked that question too, and I was like, you know, everybody talk about super teams, and I'm like, dude, like, so what do you call so a super team is you got basically in order to be a super team, you gotta be a current, I guess you gotta be a current all-star, right? And right. Is that right?
That's right.
So if you ain't current all-star, you don't qualify to be a super team, or you don't qualify to the level that people quote-unquote think or speculate or say you are. Man, right. you should be our team. Man, you're our roster, dude. Man, dude, like, I wasn't the current all-star at the time, but nigga, I was an all-star. Like, don't
right. go. Y'all was loaded, though.
Nigga, yeah. We had a
y'all
squad.
Y'all were loaded, dude.
We were a squad. Yeah. That's why we always go win.
Wasn't Tyson Chandler on that team, too?
Yeah.
Y'all was loaded.
Him and Brendan Haywood was tag team. So,
yeah.
If you want to say the roster, we had five all-stars on the team. Me, Jay Kidd.
Yeah.
Pedro Stojakovic and
I forgot about him.
Pedro and Caron Butler was on the team, even though Caron was hurt, but he still was a part of the team though. And he was all, he had been an all-star. So like
he's loaded, man.
He's on that roster, so he's part of that team. You know, even though he didn't play, but he still was on that team. He gave so much behind the scenes that people don't know. And that's my man, all those guys, that whole roster, that was a team win. I'm like, I've been talking to people.
That was a real team though. Yeah. That was a real team. A veteran team.
And you know what's crazy? And we talk about this. Jet got that tattoo on. He got a champion tattoo on his arm in preseason. That's how much dog and swag we had.
Right.
Because he had to know what kind of team we had. So my cousin said in my living room, he was like, we was in the bar chilling. He was like, man, I'm looking at y'all team, Sean. Y'all go out here. Y'all go out and do what y'all do. Y'all gonna win a championship. There. Ain't nobody beating y'all. Y'all gonna go out there and beat everybody. Can nobody match up with y'all?
Right. Yeah. And then you got Dirk.
Yeah.
Your boy Dirk, dog. Yeah. But Dirk with that truth. I'm sorry, Lib. I just had to ask that question. Dirk with that deal, man. Dirk
balled out, man. You know, like, you know, we he led and we followed, man. You know,
right.
You gotta have guys that, in order for you to win a championship, everybody has to contribute. You only gonna go as far as your bench take you. Remember that. Ain't no championship that won with no bench. You heard it right here. So, guys, they play 2 minutes, 4 minutes, or 5 minutes. Your bench plays a significant part in how far you go down in the postseason. You know what I'm saying? And it's only so far your starters can take you. You know what I'm saying? They can get you. Your bench play a part through that whole season. Do all that stuff, getting you ready for going against each other during the practice and all that stuff, getting you ready for the opponents. And they play key parts in all that stuff.
Wow.
So,
Sean, we wasn't live. Now we live. We actually Facebook live. And I know we have talked about LeClaire Courts when you was hooping. With you saw all them fancy cars out there, man. And we just went live now with it. So they didn't hear all that, man, when you was talking about you saw all them whips out there.
Well, you recorded it. They're gonna have to get it back then.
Nah, Lib, it's live, man.
I know it's live now, but me and him was on before you got on, man. And we was
right.
Zoom. But Sean was talking about some stuff, man. But yeah, we'll replay that later.
I got one more question, Sean. All right, take me through 2003. You got MJ in his final All-Star game, and he hit the lucky fadeaway out of bounds.
Yes,
sir. You played the hell out of him, dog.
Hey, listen. Sometimes, you know, one of the things that's so special about that, you know, it was his last All-Star, but, man, Mariah Carey in that Jordan dress, though, singing the anthem. Like, you know, that stands out more than anything too as well. But you know, but listen. So I said this on the Instagram on the show live yesterday with Karan too, because he was talking about it too, and they showed it. And if you look at the picture that he took, I'm all over him. I'm like,
I know that you undressed him.
So this is when when All Star really was. That's my first All Star, his last, and like that's when the All Star game was really competitive because. You know, a lot of people know this, but whoever wins get a bigger bonus.
Right.
Exactly.
Right.
So look, Popovich was like, man, Matrix, I need you to go in there and stop him, right? I'm like, all right, okay, whatever. I got you. It's going. I need you going to guard MJ. I was like, okay, cool.
Okay.
So I'm in there, man. You know, and I'm like, I'm locked in. I'm like, we want to win. You know what I'm saying? And man. Like when you look at it, you would think where my hand is in the release. You would think I should have blocked it.
Right.
But man, you know, like sometimes there's great defense, but it's better offense, and that was one of those situations. And I was like, you know, if I'm on, you know, saying I can't be mad at, you know, saying he hit that shot on me. I'm like, I'm not mad. That's MJ. I'm like,
MJ, right?
Come on, I'm not even mad at that. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They sent me that they reposted that today, the video or the picture of it, and they was like, they said, well, I messed it up. I ain't messed shit up. He made it up. Ain't my fault. Kobe got fouled and hit the
shit. Yeah, y'all had that game won, right?
Yeah.
Y'all had that game won.
We won it. So if Kobe don't get fouled and hit the free throws, they won. They win.
Yep, they win, right.
No, Kobe got fouled. Kobe wanted to win too. Kobe was like, shit, I'm trying to win this too. Kobe was that dog. He was like, no, you win this shit too. Fuck that. 100.
That's crazy. That's crazy, Shawn.
Thanks for that, man. Thanks for that.
Shawn, you we got a couple of UNLV fans on here too, man. Tell them about tell them about your UNLV, you know, day, because they only got you for 1 year, right?
Yeah, they got me for one.
Yeah, got you for 1 year, man.
It was a great 1 year though.
Well, that's what I want to know. How was Tark? You know, how was Tark, man?
Yeah, Tark. Bano was my coach.
Bano, that's right. Bill was your coach. Yeah, Bill, right?
Yeah, Bill Bano.
Yeah. So Bill was that's right. Bill was your coach. So you missed Tark, man.
Yeah, I ain't that old.
Right, yeah,
Tom
was
bingo,
right?
Yeah, man, I'm only 41. I'll be 42 in about a week. Yeah.
Right.
Tell them about your experience.
You jumped me to like 47, 48 real quick. Yeah,
man, age.
I'm thinking you're right behind me, Shawn. Damn, my bad. My bad. But, yeah, you had Bill. That's right, you had Bill. Now, you led them in rebounds and scoring that year, though, right?
Yeah, and me and Greedy was tied with Steals, I think.
Greedy Daniels, that's right. Greedy. You played with Greedy Daniels, man.
I played
Who else was on that team?
Casper Kabbalah, Kevin Simmons, Brian Key. Oh, Mark Diggle was my roommate. Who else? Donovan Stewart.
I remember that team, man. Because I was living in Vegas then, actually.
Yeah. I pretty much probably just a few more guys, but yeah.
Yeah, then you left, put your name in the draft, and the rest is history, man. You played how many years?
16 years, man. Yeah, I could have played a little longer, but, you know, things happen, and, you know, situations happen during your career, your life, man, and my life changed when I became a father, man. You know, my priorities changed, you know, and that's what, I put that first, man, you know, because it was a time in my career where I was like, do I keep playing, or do I, you know, have I accomplished everything I wanted to? Have I gave the game where I can give it? And I felt like I did. I felt like I gave the game. I felt like I gave the game where I can give it. And, you know, I was ready to start the next phase of my life, man.
Shawn, 16 years, that's a long time, buddy.
Yeah.
And I see you spending time with your kid, man. That's what's up, too. And, you know, that's precious time, too, man, especially when they're small, man. So spending time like that is awesome.
Man. Just can't put a price on me, man. You know,
No. And before we go, man, I know you got to make a run because you told me you had to get up out of here, man. But I wanted to let you talk to some of our audience, man, and some of the people that's going to come back and replay it again. What kind of advice would you give to a young, up-and-coming athlete who got aspirations to become someone?
Well, you know, I think, you know, when you setting out to be an athlete, especially in this generation right now, I think it's – you can get lost in the social media world right now real quick. And you can start believing the hype before anything happened. But at the same time, I think if you can stay grounded and keep the circle around you grounded, don't feed into the yes man and everybody agreeing with you. You know what I'm saying? Be your own person. Understand that, you know what I'm saying, you gotta work to get what you really want. And I think it goes. I gotta take this call. Hold on. I have to.
All right, go ahead. I'll mute him. Right.
Yeah, what's up, man?
Yeah, Bob.
Yeah, that's good stuff, though, Liv.
Yeah.
Shawn Marion, West Waukegan, Illinois. Yeah. Legend, man. Legend. Yeah. I was looking like I want this Liv home.
Yeah, he had got the times mixed up. I think he thought it was 9 o'clock we was jumping on, so.
Yeah, I knew you would double. I knew you would be persistent.
Yeah, I got him, so he back.
8 o'clock. Don't be lying. I'm muted. Don't be lying.
Right.
8 o'clock.
I got you. It's only, you said, I got you, man. Hey, I got you, baby boy. It's
don't
all good, man.
Don't be lying, creator. Now tell me who she was.
I chopped it up as a, you know, I messed that one up. But yeah, Shawn.
Yeah, so back to what I was saying. So I would tell them to really, you know what I'm saying, focus in. They gotta, you know, you only gonna get what you get out of it, you know, and then don't stay the course. I think if you really truly wanna be a ball player, be a ball player. But at the same time though, listen, try to get as much advice you can from guys who paved the way from you. You know, so they got so much, so don't think you know everything yet. You know, you don't, you know, and just be humble. Humble yourself, man. And good things will happen for you. But I also, a lot of these guys now, I want them to get back to playing hard. I feel like they don't compete or play hard anymore. I think it's all buddy ball on the floor. Like, you score, I score. Man, no. Get on the court, man. You want to, if it's your friends, cool, we friends, when we off. When we on that court, I'm trying to take your heart. I want all of it. I want you to make me better. I want to make you better. I'm going to challenge you. Come on. Challenge each other now. So, like, that's part of the game that's missing. I think when you look at the skill level of some of these guys, it's pretty amazing. Some of these guys doing something I couldn't even do. I'm like, I'm trying to do some of this. I'm like, man, I ain't finna hurt myself doing that stuff. I'm gonna stay in my lane. But no, seriously though, take it on your own to do your due diligence and really study the craft, man, and try to be as best player as you can. Because at the same time though, and don't limit yourself to being a point guard or a shooting guard, be a basketball player. You know what I'm saying? Be able to do everything. You know what I'm saying? And that's one of the things is rarity. And one of the things I'm going to tell everybody too, when you think about the games like this, you could, there is a price for a lot of guys' talent. You can put a price on somebody's talent. You can't put a price on somebody's heart. Mm,
that's what's up.
Somebody's willing to win. One of the things you said this earlier, and you told me how I was able to adapt. You know, one of the things I pride myself in my career at Marcus, you know, you really understood how I played and what I brought to the game. I wanted to win. So I adapted my game to whatever that team needs me to do. Like, things I was doing in Phoenix or the things I did was not the same things I was doing in Miami or Toronto or even Dallas. Berlin, you know what I'm saying? I came in and I learned how to listen. Also, you know, I ain't saying I was the best player who always agreed with everything somebody said, but if I felt like it could win, I was willing to try it. But what I've been doing at the time, when I did get experience, I knew how to pick up on sets and knew what guys were doing, doing their tendencies and all this other stuff. It became so easy for me, and I was able to get away with. I mean, I was just—it was just easy. I just like taking candy from a baby out there at times. So I was able to get these passing lanes, get these deflections, and get steals and blocks because it was just like I felt like I was just playing so much harder than a lot of guys at the point before, you know. And that's one thing I believed in because. A lot of guys who – I feel like all the guys who went half-assed during that generation when I was playing against and competing them got hurt all the time. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. You know, all that stuff is a result of what you give the game. You know what I'm saying? You know, and I believed in working hard and leaving on the floor for the fans and for myself, man. I had to give myself. I knew if I gave it – I knew I couldn't be bad at nobody but myself if I knew I left on the floor, you know. And I ain't going to give it all. Then I want to point fingers or I can, it's easy to make excuses or whatever. But when I left it on the floor, all I can say, look, I played hard. And, hey, that's all I could do. I did what was in my control. I left it on the floor.
Who gave you that nickname, The Matrix? Was that Kenny Smith?
Yeah.
Yep, I thought it was. Yeah, Kenny Smith, man, that was a big up, man. I like that nickname too. That's nice.
Yeah, I mean, I that's what I'm saying. I got it the first game I ever played in the NBA, first preseason game ever. That's The Matrix.
Yeah. Hell of a name. Hell of a nickname.
Next kids, baby. Yeah, oh, no me. Hey, listen. I think it's the best nickname ever.
It's cold. It's definitely cold. It's cold.
That's a cold nickname.
Hey, I think it's the best name ever.
Man. But, man, Shawn, wait, we really appreciate you coming on, man.
No doubt.
And that was my bad, man, on the time. And I know we probably – some listeners, like, was ready and they was chiming in. But you know what? We got you on, man. I'm proud to have you, man. Proud to say I watch you play, man, a lot of hoops. And keep doing your thing, man. I know you're doing a lot of big things out there, man. So
No doubt.
I might get you – I want to get you in tune with my nephew, too, man, so you can drop some of that knowledge on him, too.
All good. No problem.
All right, Bob, you got anything else?
Man, thanks, man. Thanks for letting me come on one time with y'all, man. I know, Liv, I was slow motion. And my son got a picture with you, man, up in Chicago State. He sent it to me like, "Dad, man, it's Shawn Marion." So I mean, last year, looking out for him.
When last year I watched the gameplay?
He was on the team last year with Lance, though, man.
That was Lance's first year. Yeah.
Yeah, and he had a chance to hang out with you. And you know, I appreciate you, man, for talking to him and helping him through it, man.
No problem, man. That's what it's about.
All right, my man Shawn Marion was in the building. Y'all missed it. If y'all missed it.
All ball Chicago. Chicago.
All ball Chicago.
Marion.
Peace.
All right, fellas. Yeah.